Our first guest this morning is Eb Hinchcliffe, Executive Director of the American Chamber of Commerce in the Philippines. Eb, looking good. Happy New Year and welcome to the program.
Thank you, Michelle. Good morning. Is it too late to say Happy New Year?
No, it's never too late. We still got the Chinese New Year coming up. In the meantime, Eb, outside of political and military ties between the Philippines and the U.S. growing because of tensions with China, when you look at the economic relations, how have our economic relations transformed or grown over the last 1 to 2 years of the Marcos administration?
I actually would say it couldn't be much better. I would, you know, if I wanted to talk about a little bit about an indicator, would probably be the AmCham growth. For the last 2 years, 2022 and 2023, AmCham has added 120 plus members. I think 134 new members in 23. On an average year, that would be pre-pandemic was like 60 to 70 members a year. So when you add that many new members over the last 2 years, I think it has a good reflection of what's going on with the relationship.
Mm-hmm. All right. And so what's going on with our relationship? I mean, the proof of the pudding is in the eating, and you did say that you added so many new members. What are these members saying about the Philippines, about doing business here, and what is the AmCham's role to make sure that business continues to grow between our two countries?
It's a we play a very important role in the process. The I tell you why I'm really upbeat about the economic for 2024 and the relationship. Ambassador Mary Kay Carlson was our speaker last week, and she gave a really outstanding report about the relationship between the two countries. But from the AmCham standpoint, for example, our board meeting AmCham, we don't do mergers and acquisitions. Most of our board meetings would be consisting of sector updates. And we talk about the hospitality industry, the real estate industry, fast-moving consumer goods like Coca-Cola or SC Johnson that's on my board. All of them are very upbeat about 2024, and all of them had very positive 2023. So, even this morning I was listening, and Dan LaChica, I think yesterday, had an interview with you or somebody there at ANC, and he just got back from the semiconductor and the semiconductor industry, and they're really looking good. The IT, the BPO industry is looking good for 2023, 2024. All of us saw growth. So what AmCham, first of all, we work very closely. I'm happy to announce that if you remember Bongbong, President Marcos was in Washington, D.C., and President Biden and that discussed a trade mission. Well, that trade mission is now coming to reality. It will be on March 11 and 12. The Secretary of Commerce of the United States will be here for that. Should be here for 2 days, the 11th and 12th of March. We'll be, AmCham is working with MAP and NBC to co-host. I'll be leading it to host a breakfast probably meeting with her. But it's just, and then on top of that, and we see the word last night that the Indo-Pacific Business Forum will be again back in Manila, back in the Philippines. Unbelievable. here we have two big events in a row, and it's going to be on May 21. That'll be about 500, 600 people coming over. So exciting times that, we're working with from the U.S.-Philippine relations on businesses.
You talked about the special trade mission. This is the Biden-curated trade mission, his first trade and investment mission, the first one he's sending to Manila on March 11. I wonder, what is the focus of that trip? Are there certain industries that will be, top of mind for whoever attends that meeting with the Commerce Secretary? I mean, what do we hope to get out of it?
We don't have a full list of it. Actually, I think the list of applications was sent out yesterday or the day before, so we don't know. We can guess it'll be some of the main ones that met with him, both in New York and in Washington, D.C. I think it's going to be about 15 to 20 chief executive officers. This is not your lower level. This is your very high level. Some of them may have already be doing business in the Philippines. If not, they're talking about expanding more in the Philippines. And those that are not already here, certainly will be encouraged to invest here in the Philippines. But this is a CEO level, very high level trade mission. So exciting.
Of course, this trade mission comes on the heels of the so-called 1-2-3 agreement signing which will pave the way for nuclear power projects between the Philippines and American providers. This 123 agreement was signed back in November last year, allowing the transfer of information, nuclear material, equipment, proponents directly between the two countries. Of course, energy, I imagine, is going to be a big part. Eb, on a bigger picture, I know that the U.S. wants to make the Philippines a key hub for regional supply chains and high-quality investment. So from your perspective, from the meetings that you have with all of these high-level CEOs who are already doing business here or are looking to do business, to start one, what do you think will it take to make that goal a reality? And do you think charter change, which is very noisy and hot today, is going to be a very important, you know, condition for that to happen?
Exactly. Good point, Michelle. The charter change, AmCham's always advocated for it. I mean, back from the days of the Speaker of the House, Bill Monte, during the Aquino administration till now, we've always wanted that the economic provisions be taken out of the Constitution. But if anything past that, we are not commenting. It's not our decision or our position at all. All we want is to get the economic provisions taken out,
the restrictions.
Especially those that limit, it limits foreign equity amounts, the 60-40 rule versus 100. Back on the 123 agreement, I mean, my gosh, that was the fastest, I think, in the history of the United States to be signed, to be approved. And it's just, we know that we cannot depend upon coal forever. And so this transition period, as we go into some renewables and into, the President Marcos has expressed interest in to be able to do that and use American technology, that 123 is a very key signing. So really happy to hear that. The recent ruling that renewable energy can be 100% foreign owned, that's a great step. But we really need to get into, we'd love to see the Constitution amended to take out the foreign equity restrictions side of it.
Mm-hmm. But is it a make or break kind of condition, or we can live without it?
Well, we've lived without it for a long time.
Good point.
So I think we'll continue to live without it. I'm hoping, I'm not so optimistic that it'll be done. Usually what what has always happened is that somebody puts in the political side of it and takes out, and adds it to the economic side, and they want to give extended terms for the president or change the Senate to be a different form of et cetera. And every time that gets in there, that ends cha-cha.
Hopefully this time it's different. Eb, shifting gears from economics, let's go to the governance side. I know that AmCham is working very closely to push for good governance. That's very important for your businessmen, for your investors. What are some of the crucial programs of the chamber that are meant to support good governance, in particular the anti-red tape authority?
We are actually I'm meeting tomorrow morning. We have a big meeting at the Manila Hotel tomorrow morning with ARTA. We've had the Secretary Pettis has been our speaker last month at our lunch meeting. We're in the process of signing an MOU with ARTA. But on another note, though, we up in our branch in North Luzon, we had Mayor Magalong as our speaker last week. Uh-huh. He works something that we're very proud to work with, and that's what's called M4GG, Mayors for Good Governance. Yesterday morning, I had a early morning 9 o'clock meeting with Quezon City Mayor Joy Belmonte, and we spent most of the morning, most of the meeting talking about good governance. Luckily for us, Quezon City is an excellent example. So when this Mayors for Good Governance, M4GG, when I have people ask me about where should I invest in, one of the first things I look at is that list and say, I recommend if you want to invest in a city that has good governance, here's the group, and let them look at that list. So, we work very closely with that. I'm also currently on the board of directors for the Integrity Initiative, which is another very important, it basically says we will not pay a bribe to a government official, but we're also working to get it to include business-to-business bribes. So those type of things, very active. AmCham's on top of it. We really, our American investors demand good governance. I mean, it's just a must. So.
I'm actually looking at the list, over 100 mayors from all over the Philippines, 120 signed this pledge for good governance at UP last year, August of last year. You mentioned Benjamin Magalong of Baguio, Joy Belmonte of QC, Marikina, Kauswagan, Lanao del Norte, Basilan, Isabela, Dumaguete. Other Metro Manila mayor signatories were from Muntinlupa, Navotas, and Pasig. All right, good point there. Finally, I want to end on a very good news from the AmCham. You guys elected your first female president in the AmCham history in the Philippines after 120 years. I guess what took you so long, and how do you see the thrust? How do you see the thrust of the chamber shifting with a woman at the helm?
Well, first of all, we're thrilled. If you come to AmCham, hope you do sometime, Michelle. maybe we can do an interview over here sometime. But on our wall in our main meeting room, the Rob Sears Hall here at AmCham, we have pictures of all the presidents from 1902 to 2023. Every one of them was a man. I took AmCham 10 years ago, going on my 11th year, and it's been my target to have a female president of AmCham. And finally, in 2023, for the year 2024, we elected our first. But if you don't mind, let me protect AmCham a little bit. it's not that we're exactly a good old boys club. We're thrilled to have Sarah as our president. She's going to be outstanding. We've had Capital One as our president before. Just they're so involved and so good. So we're really looking for her help this year. But AmCham's bylaws say that the only position at AmCham board has to be an American citizen is the president. And so the problem really lies more in America, in the United States, than it does in the Philippines, because how many American women are running American companies in the Philippines? We've been trying for 10 years to find some, and there's just not been. The second part of that problem is the Philippines itself. As you well know, you do not need an American country manager, general manager over here. If you look at IBM, you know, we have a female country manager.
Eileen Chudan-Jow,
yes. If you look at all these other companies, they're all ran by Filipinos. You don't need an American to be running an American company over here. So really, it's a supply chain problem. We did not have enough women running American companies to ever get one that could be president. But man, we're so happy we finally did it. I don't say we broke the glass ceiling, but it's great to have our very first after 120 years.
And has Sarah already shared with you her priorities for this year?
Yeah, we worked very closely together on the priorities that, you know, we got to, I think, as I mentioned during our board meetings that she chairs, we don't do mergers and acquisitions, but we spend a lot of time talking about what is going to happen with AI, what's the impact of AI, we have so many good things going on. For the year, how do we continue this growth? How do we utilize AI to go to the future?
All right, still AI. Eb, thank you so much for joining us.
Good to see you, Michelle. Thanks.
Yes, and we hope to speak to Sarah soon. We hope you could help us.
I'll help you get her signed up. You'll enjoy it.
All right. All right. Thank you very much, and congratulations again.
Have a great day, Michelle.
Have a great day. See you soon.